Hey everybody, welcome to the channel.
Hey guys, we're your hosts, M and J.
And today, the two of us are talking about issue 4 of Captain Marvel 2019. And honestly, this issue was depressing.
We were already pretty upset about what happened to She-Hulk in the last issue, and how Carol was so condescending to her. But after what happens to Rogue in this issue, She-Hulk was lucky. The disrespect to Rogue as a character, and completely ignoring what's going on in her own book right now, is just astounding.
It doesn't even make sense for her to appear in this book, but I guess the writer isn't concerned with the current continuity right now.
Maybe they're going to tie these two stories together, but if that is the case, why would they release this before tying up her own storyline? It makes for a really confusing reading experience.
This cover is reminiscent of other covers that we've seen in the past, which also feature the two characters fighting. However, this cover refers to Carol as the one and only Captain Marvel, which is strange considering the fact that several characters have used that title before.
The book opens with Carol explaining her past history with Rogue, about how she stole her powers, abilities, and even consciousness, and she ended up trapped in Rogue's mind while her body was in a coma. Carol explains that they've made their peace since then, but that she basically hates Rogue and can't even stand looking at her face. This is something that comics have been revisiting a few times, to varying success. It's probably one of the most memorable parts of Carol Danvers' history, but it's really strange to just bring it up in this context, even with the explanation that's given in this issue, and given Rogue's current continuity with being married to Gambit and off on her own adventures.
But Carol notices that two things are off. First of all, Rogue is wearing a collar, which is probably how Nuclear Man is controlling her, but also that Rogue is draining her despite the fact that they aren't making skin contact, which is how Rogue's powers usually work.
Nuclear Man shocks Rogue unconscious and strolls in with all of his one-dimensional villainous nonsense. He says it's lovely to see Carol again, and she says lovely isn't the right word. I agree, I think fungus is more like it. He then accuses Carol of being sassy, even though she's more defiant than sassy.
And he goes on to explain why he went out of his way to capture Rogue. He claims that with her quote-unquote nemesis out of the way, Carol can finally move on with her life and focus on other important things. But this really doesn't make any sense. Carol hasn't mentioned Rogue once throughout this comic book run. She did bring up her powers being stolen to Hazmat back in the first issue, but the context was totally different. At no point was it shown that Carol was still thinking about this incident to the point where it was affecting her life. In fact, the whole point of the first issue was to show how she was moving on with her life, after a series of events that had nothing to do with Rogue. It really isn't fair to Rogue to drag her into this. There was no setup to it.
He says he's willing to answer any questions she might have because he's open to dialogue, but she doesn't end up asking any questions anyway. He just monologues. She does say that's a ridiculous thing for a dictator to say, but I guess it's supposed to be ironic.
He goes on to explain that Rogue has apparently leveled up in her abilities to the point where she doesn't need to physically touch somebody to activate them, which I'm pretty sure they made up for this comic.
It's like they just really wanted Carol and Rogue to fight, and maybe they felt that making skin contact would be too limiting. Also, don't touch her like that. Or look at her. At all. You're not worthy.
Wouldn't it be great if Gambit showed up and just punched him out? But anyway, Nuclear Man finally finishes his really long monologue by saying that he's going to let Carol regain her strength so she and Rogue can fight it out in his arena. And Carol passes out.
It's never explained how Nuclear Man managed to capture Rogue, or where Gambit is.
Not to mention, how could he capture Rogue with her new abilities, considering the fact that she could just drain him without having to touch him anyway? Maybe he ambushed her? How does he even know about their past anyway?
In the meantime, Sam and Jessica make it back to the Rebellion. They explain that Carol stayed behind so they could get away, and Sam says he heard something about Rogue, but he doesn't know what that means. I'm honestly really bothered by the way that the rest of them talk about Rogue. They say that she's a woman from Carol's past who hurt her, and that she can be very traumatic for Carol, as if Rogue isn't a person who has gone through a lot of her own stuff and has come a long way.
They're basically acting like she's just a villain instead of a poor young girl who was used and abused by Mystique.
I know that they're all Carol's friends, and maybe they're not on great terms with Rogue, but these are all supposed to be heroes. They say that she can be very dangerous, and they all have to stay calm, as if nothing has happened between the last time she stole Carol's powers and now. Rogue is a hero in her own right. She's moved on. Why don't they have any faith in her at all?
Instead of talking about how they have to go in to save Carol and Rogue, they're basically acting like Rogue is just a villain who's here to hurt Carol and the rest of them just as much as Nuclear Man. And that's really unfair. But back to the story, Somm finally reveals what happened to the men. Nuclear Man is using them as soldiers by making them pilot the new model of Metal Men. So the women go over their plan of attack and start scrambling the troops. They decide to convert their weapons to EMPs, hoping they won't harm the men inside the suits.
They ask Somm what he thinks Nuclear Man has planned for Carol. He believes Nuclear Man built the arena for a reason, specifically for Carol to fight in it to prove herself or something. So they decide to attack when the fight begins so he'll be distracted. Back in Nuclear Man's arena, the fight begins. So, kinda late on that one, guys.
So basically the last three pages was a group of people sitting around and talking, while a massive fight was going on between the main character and a foe that she's had a long history with. Comics are a visual medium, and this comic could really take advantage of that. But instead, the word bubbles take up half of the pages. The writing really needs to be tightened, and maybe they could find more visual ways to tell the story, instead of just a bunch of exposition dumps.
Maybe they could have actually shown us the men being placed inside the Metal Men suits, instead of just telling us about it. But the two of them were slugging it out, and Carol realizes that Rogue is trying to fight Nuclear Man's control. And as Rogue fans, it's honestly heartbreaking to see her like this. Carol comes up with a plan, which is basically to just let Rogue absorb her, but this time she'll take control of Rogue's body. Rogue agrees, and even though Carol instantly regrets it, they go through with it. Rogue's hair even turns blonde, and her eyes turn blue.
Now that the fight is over, the rebellion finally shows up. There's about two pages of them just getting into position. It turns out that they've made weapons and armor that basically mimic their powers. So what was the point of them losing their powers in the first place? Also, they still haven't explained how that actually happened, other than hinting that it had something to do with Nuclear Man's technology, but the whole situation is still pretty vague.
Back in the arena, Nuclear Man congratulates Rogue for winning. He says he wasn't expecting it, but he is glad that she's taken on Carol's features. How is Rogue not absorbing Nuclear Man right now? Is it something that can be controlled, or what exactly? But Carol's actually in control of Rogue's body, so she snaps the collar off.
I'm not entirely sure how that works, considering the fact that she's in the body of a mind-controlled person, but I guess only Rogue's conscious was specifically being mind-controlled. Carol shoots out of the building and sees that the women have started the battle, and she's really proud of them. And then we get a reaction shot of her four friends. They're happy to see her, although they don't seem to realize that that's Rogue's body. Where they're standing, this would probably be horrifying, because it looks like Rogue's won, and has absorbed Carol like she did all those years ago.
She confronts Nuclear Man, saying it's over, but he reveals that he had plans of his own. He says that they still haven't found his bomb, and Carol realizes the whole thing was a trap. But honestly, I don't care about a bomb. I don't really care about any of this. I care about Rogue. Carol says that it's her worst nightmare to be trapped inside Rogue again, but who's actually trapped here? She's the one in control of Rogue's body. Where's Rogue right now? Somewhere deep in the subconscious?
Rogue didn't actually have any agency throughout the entire book. She was used by Nuclear Man and Carol. And the entire time, Carol's acting like she's the victim in this situation, when it's obviously Rogue.
All these women sitting around talking about her as if she's some villain. She's been torn away from her life, from her husband. She's a victim here too. But they're acting like this was somehow her decision, when obviously it wasn't.
And that line from Nuclear Man about how he wanted to have a dialogue? I can't help but feel like that came from a disingenuous place. Like, they've probably been told that on social media when they get criticism, but then they write it off as someone with bad intentions instead of just a concerned consumer. It reminds us of Harley Quinn number 56 when that guy said he just wanted a conversation after being shot out of a window.
We know criticism is never fun to receive, but if you're going to put something out there, it's going to get criticized. That's just how it goes. The pacing pacing in this book hasn't been great since the first issue. There's been a lot of characters sitting around talking, giving exposition. It would have been nice if they had cut back on that and used that time to show Rogue and why she's here and how this happened. It would have really helped to add to her character and shown her side in this conflict. That was sorely missing. Instead, it was all about Carol. And there's two sides to every conflict. I know this is Carol's story, but if you're gonna advertise Rogue versus Captain Marvel, I think we should see the Rogue side.
But that's just our opinion. What do you guys think?
Did you like this Rogue versus Captain Marvel rematch, or do you think it could have been better executed?
But overall, this book still failed to impress us, and it was really hard seeing one of our favorite characters be dragged through the mud like that. But thanks for watching. We really appreciate it. And if you like this video, you can subscribe to our channel to see more content like this. And we'll see you in the next video. Bye, everyone.
Bye, guys.